Welcome. If everybody could come on over and have a seat, that would be great. We're going to get started. We have more chairs that we can set up if we need. To this school goes way back, a long way. My husband, Alan Lovejoy, who is here in the audience, taught here. I met him his first year of teaching here, and he taught here at Kellogg for 20 years before moving on to the high school. And our two children, who are now ages 21 and 24, also attended Kellogg, K through 8. Living out of town, we were very fortunate enough to be able to choose Kellogg as a school that we wanted our children to attend, being drawn to the multi-age class structure. Kellogg has a veteran faculty, all of whom are here tonight, some of whom have been here for 34 years, 29 years, 25 years, 24 years, and we also have teachers in their first year of teaching as well. Teachers that have been here for many, many years have stayed on in this tiny school because of its unique character and culture and sense of community. And I chose Kellogg for myself as well, not so much because I was really looking to be a principal, but because I wanted to be a part of a faculty and staff that are involved in important work and in a town that is passionate about educating their children. We, the faculty and I, organized this evening because we felt very strongly that we have something quite special here at Kellogg, and that we wanted to articulate that to you. We have a school song that was written many years ago. It's on the back of your ticket. That was written many years ago by Barbara Collins. And it starts out, "Kellogg is a very special place. At Kellogg, everybody knows your face." And it's the truth of that refrain that we hope to impart to you tonight. We have a fairly tight program planned, which begins and ends here, with four breakaway sessions in between that will have you moving to different spaces throughout the school in small groups. And following that, we'll reconvene here for a few door prizes and a closing. And at the end of the formal program, for those of you that have never been in the school before and are interested in seeing more of it, we have some student ambassadors that will be giving school tours. And then we also, for people that want to linger just even a tiny bit longer, there will be a drumming circle happening in the music room. Impromptu drumming circle with Brooke Martinez, our music teacher, at least one other student, maybe a few others, and anybody else that would like to join in, and that will just go until 9 o'clock. But we'll be finished with the formal program by 8:30. One of the practices that we use here at Kellogg is the use of learning targets. And this is a unit, a project, or lesson goal written in student-friendly language, starting with "I can," and it's shared with students at the beginning of a lesson, and it helps teachers and students zero in on the intended learning of any lesson. If you walk into any classroom at Kellogg at any time when students are engaged in learning, any student should be able to tell you what their learning target is. We have three learning targets for tonight. They're on your paper, and they're also over here on our board, and I'm going to read them to you now. I can share how a Kellogg education builds a foundation for lifelong learning and active citizenship in the 21st century. I can describe learning experiences at Kellogg and how these experiences foster high quality work and student engagement. And I can explain why Kellogg is a very special place. We know the town of Canaan, or Falls Village, has something quite unique here. As research indicates, a K-8 school provides a strong foundation for students. The longer students stay in one school, the stronger the relationships they form with teachers and other adults. And the stronger such relationships, the stronger student support system and likelihood for success. At Kellogg, not only are students known by more than one adult, they are known by all of the adults. Students that have spent their K-8 years at Kellogg leave here with a strong foundation. When there is stability and where students have an opportunity to build a strong connection to place, participation and engagement cannot be overlooked. There is no place to hide at Kellogg. Taking a back seat to learning is simply not an option. There are school systems all over the country, urban, suburban, and rural, that are reconfiguring their districts from the elementary, middle, and high school model to the K-8 and 9-12 structure. If you want to know more about this trend, on the way out, Mia Lind, one of our student ambassadors, will give you a little flyer that has some links on it. And there is a link on that to an article on that topic published by the American Association of School Administrators. Here at Kellogg, we have embraced the K-8 model and are committed to creating experiences spanning the ages so students can learn and benefit from each other. You will learn about some of these experiences following my introduction when we break out to mini sessions. But briefly, we not only have multi-grade classes, which consist of K-2, 3-4, and some 5-6 and 7-8 as well, and we even have one class that's a 6-7. We also embrace multi-grade experiences, both academic and social. The third and fourth graders may come to the K-1-2 to offer some peer review on storybook character sketches, or the K-4 students may attend a colonial fair presented by the seventh grade, or the honors biology class at Housatonic may come and support our K-2 students as mentors in their research on animals of Falls Village. Next week, our first and second graders will be sharing their paintings and persuasive writing on how to save the world from a young child's perspective with our eighth graders, who are in the midst of their eighth grade projects with a similar theme. Some worry that Kellogg is too small. I am not one to profess that one size fits all. For some, a Montessori education might be right. For others, a private elementary prep school. For others, homeschooling. And for some, a large suburban or inner city school. And for many, a small K-8 school in rural Falls Village. Never did folks used to say that a one-room schoolhouse with K-12 is detrimental to the health and well-being of children. Indeed, the factory model of grouping children together by age rather than readiness only began in the mid-1880s as an efficient way to educate large numbers of children when a free public education became a universal and eventually a mandated right. When children play with others outside of school, rarely is it with only children born in their year. None of us work or socialize with people only born in our year. At Kellogg, we have children playing and learning alongside other children of all ages. You will hear about our Bunches program in one of the breakout sessions, and currently the faculty is working on a plan for the fall for a weekly all-school community meeting to recognize and celebrate the character and culture of who we are. We're a school that is forever evolving, and we truly embrace a growth mindset in what we do and how we do it. Our faculty is a mirror of our school. We have a small student body, and we have a small faculty. This allows us the opportunity to sit around a table together for intense professional development and conversation about who we are as an educational institution, what we do, why we do it, and where we might want to go. It is rare that a school can claim 100% engagement in faculty meetings. Kellogg can because we are a faculty that feels empowered to make educational decisions based on individual students or class groups because we can. Our smallness is an asset, and we don't take that for granted. We embrace it. Last year, we discovered the work of Expeditionary Learning, an educational nonprofit that embraces a set of practices that puts students at the forefront of their learning. Through the inspiring work of EL Schools, along with a consultant, Freeman Stein, who is here with us tonight to help us celebrate our work, we have looked at our professional practices at Kellogg and are making changes in the way we approach teaching and learning embracing practices that engage students in their learning, and creating authentic, meaningful, community-based experiences. You'll learn about some of these tonight. We have four breakout sessions that are each 15 minutes long. We're going to have you travel to each session in a group that is determined by the color of the ticket you received when you came in tonight, which is that piece of paper. You'll be escorted by two student ambassadors who will stay with you for your session, and then they will take you on to the next one. Please keep track of, follow, and stay with your student ambassador. We are on a tight schedule, and at the end of the four sessions, we'll reconvene here for a few closing remarks and door prizes. Remember our three learning targets. One, I can share how a Kellogg education builds a foundation for lifelong learning and active citizenship in the 21st century. Two, I can describe learning experiences at Kellogg and how these experiences foster high-quality work and student engagement. And three, I can explain why Kellogg is a very special place. So, our student ambassadors are ready, and so I'm going to give you some directions, and you're going to go along with them. So if you hear a faculty member that is giving a presentation, you might want to leave now. Okay, so, if everyone with a blue ticket, so if you're the blue ticket ambassadors, that should be Tessa and Neiland. Okay, there's Tessa and Neiland. If you have a blue ticket, if you could get up and go with Tessa and Neiland right now. And Tessa and Neiland, you're gonna start down in room 7, Miss Gargan's room. Okay, so head on down. Okay, Tessa and Neiland, head on down. Go ahead.
Didn't you hear?
Have see the light.
Okay.
Good evening. I'm Paula Rogers, and I'm the 5th through 8th language arts teacher down here in the middle school. This evening, we're going to share with you information on academic rigor. Our learning target for this evening is I can identify strategies used at Lee H. Kellogg School to develop academic rigor. Think back to your experience in grammar school and consider these two classrooms where both classes are reading The Outsiders by S.E. Hinton. In classroom number 1, the instructor begins his or her lesson by saying, "Today we will continue to read chapters 6 and 7 in The Outsiders, and you're to answer the questions in the study guide as you read. The first 10 questions focus on the main events in the book, and the next 10 questions address the conflict in the novel." In classroom number 2, the instructor begins the lesson by stating the learning target, providing criteria for success, and alerting the students to the performance of understanding. Today, we are learning to compare the values and belief systems of both The Outsiders and The Socias. Identify each of the claims and then support your findings with specific details from the book. In classroom 1, the student is flying blind. Even though the instructor has explained the expectations, the students are left not knowing what they're supposed to be learning throughout the lesson. The student is left to waste valuable time trying to figure out what the teacher's expectations are and how to achieve them. Many of us have had multiple educational experiences similar to classroom number 1. Today, the teachers at Kellogg embrace and are committed to the usage of learning targets. To quote Brookhart and Moss, the authors of Learning Targets, quote, "The most effective teaching and the most meaningful learning happen when teachers design the right learning target for today's lesson and use it along with their students to aim for and assess understanding. Learning targets are student-friendly descriptions of what the student is able to accomplish during a lesson. Could be words, pictures, or actions. When used effectively, students can see the expectations and direct their efforts toward these objectives. Learning targets help teachers to plan, monitor, assess, and improve the quality of learning opportunities to raise the achievement of all students. Let's look at some samples of these learning targets. K2, I can look closely at the pictures in a nonfiction text to help me learn more about my topic in a way that goes beyond the words on the page. Grades 3-4, I can identify elements within a picture to help me understand vocabulary. Grades 5-6, I can identify elements of the universal refugee experience from pictures in a nonfiction text. As learning progresses throughout the grades, each student is adapting to a rigorous learning experience, as well as the language and expectations that become part of their foundation for assessing their own learning.
Hey, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Linda Sloan, and I'm one of the teachers in our K-12 multi-age classroom. And as a faculty, after thinking about and researching best practice for helping our students to meet Common Core standards, we agreed that we would all commit to using Turn and Talk, a routine that is now used in every classroom at Kellogg to support the acquisition of speaking and listening skills throughout the grades. It is an oral language support strategy that provides students with a structured opportunity to formulate ideas and share their thinking with another student. After this talk occurs, a small amount of time is given to share and process Turn and Talk conversations. The Common Core state standards mandate attainment of speaking and listening skills, kindergarten through 12th grade, which can be learned and practiced through Turn and Talk routines. This slide reinforces how Turn and Talk is grounded in research on the important link between oral language and the development of thinking skills. And I particularly like this middle one. When working collaboratively, students have an opportunity to share their thoughts and opinions in mutually respectful ways. They are actively engaged and leaders of their own learning. They are able to work through complex problems and situations in order to develop new learning and understandings. When many of us were in school, the teachers asked questions and we responded by putting our hands up and being called on. However, as many of you remember, soliciting responses to teacher questions often limited discussion. Students either chose not to respond at all, or the same students responded time and again. Teachers routinely called on them to move the discussion along and get to the right answer. When classroom participation structures like Turn and Talk are used, all students are required to share their thinking, not just a select few, but they can do so in a more comfortable and developmentally appropriate setting. This is an easy participation structure to establish and use in the full range of settings in classroom instruction in all content areas. It is particularly useful for helping students to develop deeper thinking skills, like the ability to make comparisons, monitor comprehension, respond to or summarize texts, brainstorm, problem solve, express opinions, review or recall material, and make deeper and more meaningful connections. Turn and Talk provides the thinking and discussion skills that are a cornerstone of learning and communicating. It is also a fun and engaging routine for the students. So we'd like to give you all a second to turn and talk to a neighbor about why Turn and Talk is such an effective instructional tool and how this might have helped you as a student when you were in school. So find someone you can turn and talk to.
I'm Jen.
So now you all got to feel a little bit of what it's like to be a student in our class when we're asked to turn and talk.
Good evening.
Getting back into control. Okay.
Good evening. I'm Robin Fast, and I'm the other K-12 multi-age teacher here at Kellogg. And tonight, I want to talk about students producing high-quality work. This is our expectation as teachers, and we want to support students in developing the growth mindset and habit that leads to high-quality work. So how do we go about achieving this goal? Well, one way is to connect all learning and its purpose back to the learning targets.
We want our students to own these learning targets and to work towards meeting them. We continually refer back to the learning target within each lesson and ask students to reflect on how they are doing in meeting the learning target. Are they hitting the target, on their way, or just beginning to move towards that target? We always want our students to know where they are headed in their learning, whether it be in the short term or in the long term. An important component of high quality work is the use of rubrics, a tool that allows students to gauge progress towards a daily or long-term target. With the roadmap and destination clear, high quality work is a more likely outcome. One way we can do this is by creating rubrics. Rubrics can be created by the teacher, but we are also creating rubrics in collaboration with our students. We do this by asking the students to uncover qualities and characteristics in a model we've studied and by thinking about all the learning targets. What's important in this learning? To do this, we may use mentor text or exemplar products created by us or by former students. When students can look at the expectations and have a say in its components, they are taking on ownership in the creation of the rubric. When students are more invested in their work, they are more likely to produce high quality work. Another way we strive for high quality work is through lots of specific feedback between the teacher and the student, and the student and the student. Feedback must be kind, specific, and helpful. Students may engage in peer feedback in numerous ways: whole group, looking at a student's work, in small groups, and in partnerships. In theory and in practice, when a student can look at another student's work and find strengths in an assignment and those that can be improved upon, they can then look back in their own work with a more critical eye and a careful lens. Research indicates that specific and effective feedback raises student achievement more strongly and consistently than any other teacher behavior. This ongoing emphasis on self-assessing one's own work and working towards a standard through learning targets is how we are transferring ownership to our students to develop the important growth mindset and habit of mind that their work can always be improved upon and that doing high quality work really matters.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Eileen Gargan. This is my classroom. I'm a multi-age teacher, grades 3 and 4. And this spring, we piloted in 3rd and 4th grade a different structure for parent-teacher conferences. Instead of doing the parent-teacher conferences, the students actually led the conference. They had student-led conferences. A student-led conference is a planned event in which the student presents his or her work to family members and reflects on the habits of work which led to success and or difficulties. The student also sets goals for continued learning. We wanted to do this because we're hoping to develop even more awareness and responsibility with students for their own learning. In order to have a student-led conference, the students had to choose significant learning targets, really large, long-term targets. They looked through their assignments. We had a whole bunch of work. They compiled examples of work that demonstrated progress towards a goal or towards a target, and you can see they're sitting with their units of work here. They then organized and wrote notes on the evidence. You can see they have post-its here, they highlighted, they looked at the work and they really reflected upon it so that they could really speak about their strengths and weaknesses. Throughout the process, the students were able to clearly see how the different activities and assignments helped them to get closer to the target, to reaching the target. This practice enabled them to recognize habits of work, which are very, very important. Habits of work that help them or hinder them. Some of the students found that they were very organized in their work, and it really helped them to go back and revise. Whereas other students said, oh, I should reread that. I really didn't intend to write that particular, what I actually wrote. The structure of the student-led conference aligns very well with our Common Core standards, especially our speaking standards. Students practice explaining their work. There's Gus. And they practice. And they practice. There I am with a wet noodle behind them. Yeah. Near the day of the conference, they rehearse by presenting the work to their peers. Finally, the day arrives, they lead the conference, the teacher is there, we just help facilitate, and they get feedback from their parents. We wanted to see how the students felt the process went. They said it was really hard, but they also felt that it was very good to learn how to present things, and it was really good to know what the goals were. We had to start very early in the year making sure we had good learning targets. And they thought finding and giving proof of a learning target was a very good idea. We also wanted to make sure that we addressed the parents' needs. Now, parents could always call a conference, but this was a different way to do it. And we got very positive comments from this. They were quite impressed with their child's organization and pretty impressed that they could reflect on their learning targets as well as they could. So hopefully it's opening up more conversations at home. So now, let's see how you did. Our learning target for this session was I can identify strategies used at Kellogg to develop academic rigor. Did you meet that? Can you think of any strategies? If you can, you can say them. You can just think about them. I won't put you on the spot. And how many of the following were you able to identify? We use learning targets, turn and talk, rubrics, exemplar models, student and teacher feedback, and student-led conferences. We're hoping to do student-led conferences in fifth and sixth grade also next year. So it'll be third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. It will probably only be in the spring, though, and we'll have the traditional parent-teacher conferences in the fall. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, welcome to your second room of the night. In here, we're going to talk about technology at Kellogg. So, my name is Brooke Martinez. I'm the music teacher here at Kellogg, and I teach middle school band and chorus, and I also teach K through 4 technology.
My name is Joe Marco. I teach science for 5th through 8th grade, and I also teach 7th grade math here at Kellogg.
So we're going to show you our learning target for this room. I can describe how technology is integrated across the educational program at Kellogg School. So the key word there is integrated, as will be highlighted using this smart board. We don't just teach technology and how it works. We use it in everything we do here, and it's a big part of 21st century education. So one of the advantages of being a small rural school is that we have a high ratio of computers per student. It's 1 to 2. So when a student needs to access something for their education, they have access to it here. This is a technology class similar to what I teach once a week. Every grade, K through 8, gets its own technology class once a week. And 4th and 5th grade is really the best time for students to dig into serious keyboarding skills, and they get it 3 times a week, because that is proven by data that 3 times a week for 20 minutes really will get them typing fast and efficiently.
The device that we're using right now is called an interactive whiteboard. There's a misconception many times that this is just an electronic blackboard, but it's really a much more powerful tool. It's interactive both from an instructional standpoint, and also the students are often up at the whiteboard doing various activities. The first screen here is going to be from the 3rd and 4th grade classroom. This would be a lesson page where they have notes provided to them over here, directions, and then a space for them to come up to the board and write their own notes. Those from previous ones. And we could even have a timer here if we were trying to pace out an activity and they wanted to check on it throughout the lesson. Sometimes it's handy to be able to have a conversation with the students before you reveal the answer or some information, and so it's nice to have these types of options, and at the same time it's very efficient to teach with. There are also many websites and other software programs that allow students to learn right up here at the whiteboard. This is an interactive whiteboard. This one helps the primary grade students learn to identify the correct times on a clock. And in a middle school science room, you might walk into the classroom and you can immediately write down your homework, read the learning target. The first question of the lesson is already on the board, and they have a sequence of what will be happening that day, so they can make the most of the time that they have, especially the precious laboratory time. It really is an interactive tool. In this case, students might be reviewing for a test on the parts of the eye, and so they might start trying some of those, and then they can see how they did. And I clearly need to study a little bit more on that one. A simple math problem becomes a much more, you can do a lot more with the smart board than just solve the problem. In this case, we're going to create a bar graph where students put their own responses up here, and it's set up as a multiple choice question. And following that, we not only solve the math with them, but we can also talk about strategies for solving a multiple choice question like that. So you can see students are really working with these tools as much as the teachers are. And smart boards or interactive whiteboards are located in almost every room within Kellogg School. Now we're talking about a lot of the technology in the school, and right here located at this table, these are many of the items that students can actually have access to or even check out from the library and use either in school or at home. But sometimes we take advantage of technology that's outside of the school too, and this is in the all-purpose room. You can actually see the Pilgrim Diaries videos that the students produced at the local cable station. And they went there and used the green screen and then inserted a background into the video behind them.
So a really useful device that we use a lot here at Kellogg is called Document Camera. Some of you may remember the old projectors with the light that shines on the screen and you have to have the plastic slide, but it's difficult to print stuff on the practice slide. So this is basically a digital camera that hooks right into the smart board. So say in first and second grade, they were editing their papers. Instead of showing each student, here's what we need to do, the teacher can edit it in front of everyone so everyone can learn from one correction. So it creates a pretty efficient classroom often. In science, the science room, you can also use it as a sort of low magnification microscope if you want to share something, whether it's a book or a shell or something like that. And if this, you know, if you need to take it to the next level, Joe has a high-powered digital microscope, which he's going to share with you now.
The science room has two digital microscopes. One is located here, and then the other one is this small device. And it has a lens on it right now that magnifies 50 times. We'll take this horseshoe crab, and horseshoe crabs on their exoskeleton, they actually have a compound eye. We'll magnify that 50 times, and you can see all the hundreds of little lenses that make up that compound eye on the horseshoe crab. Now, one of the benefits of this is there are times where you have 20 microscopes set up in the classroom, and students are seeing different things, and a student might be seeing an air bubble and thinking it's a cell. And by having the ability to project it on the board like this, we can make sure students are really seeing everything that we expect them to be seeing with the microscopes.
So around the room, you will see there's a cart full of laptops. Those are Acer laptops. In our computer lab, we have PCs with running Windows operating system. These are running Linux operating systems, so the students are getting a flavor for the main three operating systems, the third being the Apple OS system. We do have iPads over here that we're starting to integrate in our curriculums as well. So they're really getting a good feel for all the technology that's out there. The third and fourth grade use these Nooks for reading. And take it away, Joe. He's going to talk about how he uses this laptop in his science lab.
One of the advantages in the science lab is we have a laptop here that's connected to a Vernier Lab Pro, and then that has a thermometer that's inserted inside this test tube. We're actually collecting data on the freezing and melting of water. We have it soaking in a salt water ice bath, and the result is that we can collect the data in real time, and the students actually see the data forming as the temperature drops. From time to time, it's convenient to be able to collect it like this directly on the computer, and then students get a sense of how that data forms over time, and it's a little bit quicker for analysis too at times.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about my music program and how I specifically run the middle school band, which I think is unique in that I'm using technology as a tool to really customize the music to the students' abilities individually and as a group, and maximizing my results. He's going to switch the screen over, and I'm going to show you a little video of how I do it on my laptop. So, can we back it up? Here it goes, Kellogg, Band, Middle School. So, I love working with student ideas and having the students bring ideas to me and then making it a reality. So this is an example of how one student, Matthew Lopes, came to me and said, Mr. Martinez, we're doing all the other songs. Can we please do a song by AC/DC? And I said, sure, let's work with AC/DC. So I went through my AC/DC albums and I came up with Back in Black. I picked that song. This is sort of how he comes to me with an idea and I can sort of weed through what songs by AC/DC would be best for the band. And this one I thought would be challenging, but achievable. So the first thing I do after I get the song, I bring it in this program on my laptop called The Amazing Slowdowner, which does just that. It can slow down a song without changing the pitch of the song. But it can also change the pitch of the song no matter what speed it's going. So for me as a band leader, really middle school band, you're talking B flat or F, or their relative minors. You can't do that many keys because they're just learning the instruments. So this song is in every guitarist's favorite key, E, but really for band instruments, for me to bring it up to F is very helpful for them to achieve success. So I'm gonna play some of the song, and then you're gonna see this nudge up, and you might be able to hear it go up a half step. Here and it went up a little bit, just a tiny bit. And then, say I want to slow the song down so the kids can hear the parts. It's going to get slower. See, so now it's slower so they can play along if it's too fast at first for them to play along with. So I have to create a score. That's my next move when I have a song. So I have all the instruments of the band members in this program called Sibelius, and then I'm customizing, tailorizing who plays what parts, what their range is with trumpets, trombone, flute, clarinet, saxophone, synthesizer, and piano, and accordion. We have an accordion player. And I can play the score back for them. So you can hear the similarity. We moved it up to F, and I arranged it into the instruments. The video is a little choppy, but normally it doesn't have those breaks in it. So one of the advantages of this program is I can send them the recording of this with their part a little louder, so they can learn it by ear and by reading the music. So it's really differentiating learning for different people. So I'm playing a high G and a low G there for trumpet. High G is pretty high for beginning trumpet, so I wanted to challenge my my eighth grade trumpet players to get that high G, and they were excited to work towards it. Whereas my younger trumpet players were ready for the low G. They're just learning how to read. You can see sometimes I have to put notes in for them to help them with the reading, and I gradually take them out. Now if that's the high G. I can bring that note down in real time. Say one of my trumpet players, it was just too high for them. I can adjust everything as needed. I can also add whatever, I can adjust lines in the song to the level that I think would challenge them but be appropriate for them. Like this fast line is pretty hard, but I was able to make it achievable through my own arrangement. So most band directors take other people's arrangements and adapt, try and make their band do it, where I am customizing my arrangements with the technology, and these are different parts. So I print this out and give it to the flute player. So the final result, hopefully it won't be too choppy, but this is from this year's winter concert, from student idea to this performance, which is going to play. I didn't want to do it.
We've been playing it too many times today.
So you could hear a little. You hear that high G? I can't sing it. But anyway, I promise you that they do a pretty good job of this. And we put the video out there if you need to see it. So that's how I use technology in my classroom.
We use a lot of software in the music room and in other classrooms. There are tools that help students practice their learning skills, and also we've shown you some of the things that teachers use to help instruct students. Here's an example of a math website, IXL, with the list of math skills that students can choose to practice, and it would give them a whole series of practice problems. They can do this both at school and at home when they log in. Our textbooks often come with online lessons, so many times we can use the lessons, and they're interactive as well. And Discovery Education gives us access to full videos and also video segments, which for teaching we love because we can show a 2 to 3 minute segment in the middle of a lesson and not have to watch a whole half hour video. Here's an example. We have a woman here swinging an object in a physics video, and we had we paused the video and had the students come up and draw where they predicted the object would fly off when she let go. And then we could talk about, you know, the science behind that, and then play the video and actually see which direction it goes. Burke mentioned earlier that some of our computers have the Linux operating system. It's a real advantage for students at Kellogg here to get experience with 2 or 3 operating systems, because when they go to the high school or they get a career outside of school, they're going to have the flexibility to work with different types of computers and software. Here's an example of an 8th grade project where the 8th grader is producing a website as part of their 8th grade project this year. And so just learning how to use various packages, and also, you know, it's great preparation for both high school and college. And in 5th grade, the science curriculum is actually worked into the technology classes. They use Adobe Photoshop to create the phases of the moon as one of their activities in technology class. And that's also part of the science curriculum.
Now, some of you might recognize this is a Google Doc, which is sort of an online version of Microsoft Word. A big buzzword in technology these days is everything's in the cloud. And because this is in the cloud or up on the internet, when you save a file here, it's not on your computer, it's on the internet, and it's shareable. So we certainly take advantage of Google Docs here at Kellogg, where we can see student work not just at the end when it's grade time, but we can work them through the process as they go along and help them along the way. Another big sharing tool for teachers here is PowerSchool, which is our way of having a platform for teachers to post grades, and at any time a parent and student can see the grades, even for tests, not just for the end of the term. So this is a real interactive advantage that Kellogg is using in its middle school to help parents, students, and teachers stay on the same page about their students' progress.
I'm just going to go back for 1 second. One real advantage of this was, let's just say the student didn't have a printer at home. The student can share it with me here, I can print it out, or I can view it. So it really eliminates a lot of excuses, but it also gives us the opportunity to really share those things.
Yeah, and on Earth Day, it saves paper. So thank you very much.
Thank you for coming today.
Welcome, everybody. I'm so glad that you're here tonight. I am Jandy Hanna. I'm a speech and language pathologist in this school and also in Cornwall. I work for Pupil Services, but this is my town. I live across the street, so I'm really glad to be here tonight. This is not my room, though. Speech room's a lot smaller. But this is the lovely Amy Lake's wonderful social studies room, and if you get a chance to look around, you'll see it's an extremely interesting place to be. I love the time that I'm able to be in this classroom with her. Tonight, we're going to watch a TED Talk. Do you want to start a minute, Paul? Okay, well, not quite yet. The TED Talks, if you don't know about them, you're going to discover a wonderful opportunity here. I do want to keep you from worrying. There will be a piece of paper that, when you leave, has the link to this TED Talk, so you will be able to get to it later on. We're going to listen to Eduardo Brineco. I had his name and I've lost it. He is going to talk to us about growth mindset. Did you get the lights, please, Neil? Thank you.
What do you think is the key to achieving our goals, our success? Some people suggest things like hard work, focus, persistence. But research shows these are all byproducts of something else, something much more powerful that we can all develop. It is this very special something that really is critical to success, and is what I'm here to discuss with you today. Someone who has achieved great success is Josh Waitzkin, a chess international master and the subject of the movie Searching for Bobby Fischer. Nobody has won all the national chess championships that Josh has. But even more impressive, when he turned 21, he took on the challenge of mastering something completely new and very different from chess. martial arts. He realized that he had learned how to grow and succeed, and he could apply that understanding to other domains. And so, he devoted himself relentlessly to Tai Chi Chuan. And after lots of hard work, many failures, and some broken joints, he became a great martial artist, and he won 2 world championships. Now he's off to jiu-jitsu. So what does Josh say is the greatest thing that ever happened to him? Believe it or not, he says, losing my first national chess championship because it helped me avoid many of the psychological traps. The key trap that Josh avoided was believing that he was special, that he was smarter than other people, and that he didn't have to work hard. He could have thought of himself as a prodigy, but he doesn't think that he has extraordinary intelligence. He says, the moment we believe that success is determined by an ingrained level of ability, we will be brittle in the face of adversity. Josh often quotes Stanford professor Carol Dweck, who discovered that some people see intelligence or abilities as fixed, what is called a fixed mindset, while other people see them, as Josh does, as qualities that can be developed, a growth mindset. More important, Dr. Dweck discovered that these 2 different mindsets lead to very different behaviors and results. In a study she did with Dr. Lisa Blackwell, several 100 seventh graders were surveyed to determine which mindset each student had, and then they were tracked for 2 years. Results showed that the students with a growth mindset, those who thought they could change their own intelligence, increased their grades over time, while those with a fixed mindset did not. You can see the trend. The gap in performance just widens and widens over time. The difference between these 2 groups? A different perspective on intelligence. Other studies have shown similar effects for our mindset about other abilities, like problem solving, playing sports, managing people, or anything else you'd like. Dancing La Macarena. The key to success is not simply effort or focus or resilience, but it is the growth mindset that creates them. The mindset itself is critical. Research shows that when we directly try to build grit or persistence, it is not nearly as effective as addressing the mindset that underlies them. How many of us think of ourselves as not math people, or creative, or sociable, or athletic? Or conversely, that we're naturals? If we're to fulfill our potential, we have to start thinking differently. We have to realize that we're not chained to our current capabilities. Neuroscience shows that the brain is very malleable, and we can change our own ability to think and to perform. In fact, many of the most accomplished people of our era were thought of by experts to have no future. People like Charles Darwin, Lucille Ball, Marcel Proust, and many others. But they, along with all great achievers, from Mozart to Einstein, built their abilities. But the key insight that I'd like you to walk away with today is that when we realize that, when we realize that we can change our own abilities, when we have a growth mindset, we bring our game to new levels. So how does a growth mindset do that? It turns out that there are physiological manifestations to mindset. Brain scans show that for people with a fixed mindset, the brain becomes most active when receiving information about how the person performed, such as a grade or a score. But for people with a growth mindset, the brain becomes most active when receiving information about what they could do better next time. In other words, people with a fixed mindset worry the most about how they're judged, while those with a growth mindset focus the most on learning. There are other consequences of mindset. People with a fixed mindset see effort as a bad thing, something that only people with low capabilities need, while those with a growth mindset see effort as what makes us smart, as the way to grow. And when they hit a setback or failure, people with a fixed mindset tend to conclude that they're incapable, so to protect their ego, they lose interest or withdraw. We observe that as lack of motivation, but behind it is a fixed mindset. Whereas people with a growth mindset understand that setbacks are part of growth. So when they hit one, they find a way around it, like Josh Waitzkin did when he lost in chess or in martial arts. Research clearly shows these effects of mindset. In one study that Dr. Dweck did with Dr. Claudia Mueller, they had children do a set of puzzles. And then they praised the kids. To some of the kids, they said, "Wow, that's a really good score. You must be smart at this." That's fixed mindset praise because it portrays intelligence or abilities as a fixed quality. To other kids, they said, wow, that's a really good score. You must have tried really hard. That's growth mindset praise because it focuses on the process. Then they asked the kids, okay, what kind of puzzle would you like to do next? An easy one or a hard one? The majority of the kids who received the fixed mindset praise chose to do the easy puzzle, while the great majority of those who received the growth mindset praise chose to challenge themselves. Then the researchers gave a hard puzzle to all of the kids because they were interested in seeing what confronting difficulty would do to their performance. Look at what happened when the kids later went back to the set of easier problems that they started with. The kids who received the fixed mindset praise did significantly worse than they had originally, while those who received the growth mindset praise did better. And to top it off, at the very end, kids were asked to report their scores. And the kids who received the fixed mindset praise lied about their scores over 3 times more often than those who received the growth mindset praise. They did not have another way to cope with their failure. The difference between these two groups? One short little sentence. How often do we praise kids for being smart or for being great at something? We've been told that this will raise their self-esteem, but instead, it puts them in a fixed mindset. They become afraid of challenges and they lose confidence when things get hard. As Josh Waitzkin says, it is incredibly important for parents to make their feedback process related, as opposed to praising or criticizing talent. If we win because we're a winner, then when we lose, it must make us a loser. These studies show not only the mechanisms by which mindset affects performance, but they also show something else that's very important. They show that we can change mindsets, and that's important because most of us have fixed mindsets about something. Another study that showed that we can change mindsets is one in which Dweck and Blackwell did a workshop with 7th graders to instill a growth mindset in them. As a result of the workshop, the students gained more interest in learning and they worked harder, and as a result of that, their grades improved. Other studies have shown that when we teach a growth mindset, not only does it improve achievement for students as a whole, but it also narrows the achievement gap because the effects are most pronounced for the students who face negative stereotypes, such as minority students and girls in math. I've spoken mostly about children, but mindset affects all of us. In our workplaces, managers with fixed mindsets don't welcome feedback as much, and they don't mentor employees as much. And employees with growth mindsets about specific skills, like negotiations, become far better at those skills than people with fixed views. Mindsets can even help us solve big social issues. A recent study showed that when we expose Israelis and Palestinians to the idea that groups can change, they increase their attitudes toward one another, they improve them, and they enhance their willingness to compromise and to work for peace. We also see the effects of mindsets on relationships, sports, health. How is it possible that as a society, we're not asking schools to develop a growth mindset in children? Our myopic efforts to teach them facts, concepts, and even critical thinking skills is likely to fail if we don't also deliberately teach them the essential beliefs that will allow them to succeed, not only in school, but also beyond. There's a lot that we can do to change mindsets, but here are 3 things that any of us can do to instill a growth mindset in ourselves and in those around us. First, recognize that the growth mindset is not only beneficial, but it's also supported by science. Neuroscience shows that the brain changes and becomes more capable when we work hard to improve ourselves. Second, learn and teach others about how to develop our abilities. Learn about deliberate practice and what makes for effective effort. When we understand how to develop our abilities, we strengthen our conviction that we're in charge of them. And third, listen for your fixed mindset voice. And when you hear it, talk back with a growth mindset voice. If you hear, "I can't do it," add, "yet." My request to you today is that you share this knowledge about the growth mindset with your family, friends, and schools, so that all of us can go and fulfill our potential. Thank you.
you.
Hello, come in. So, does anyone have any questions? We have a few minutes until the bell is going to ring that would signal the time to go to your next breakout group. If you don't, I can tell you that one of the reasons that we were excited about this particular TED Talk, and I must say I am also excited about the woman who's mentioned several times, Carol Dweck, also has her own TED Talk that has been done recently, and you can search for that and find her. It's very good. But also, when Jenny Law told us about this TED Talk, those of us who hadn't seen it before got really excited because we realized that it espouses what we're trying to do with expeditionary learning ideals. That the idea that I will be able to do it with enough effort, with enough problem-solving skills, and with my team, and with my learning targets, and with my teacher's help, that I can do those things as learning targets is very, very powerful. It's a very powerful idea. I particularly like the part where Eduardo says, brains have been shown, fixed mindset brains, to have more electrical activity in them when they're told they got a good score. So it's like, woo-hoo, me, right? Oh, my brain is excited because, oh, I did so well. That's a fixed mindset. Whereas the growth mindset is more active, there's more electrical action going on when there's a way to grow, when the mind is saying, I can try this instead. And that, to me, is the kind of student we want. So I find this, having watched it several times, really useful. And I hope you can see why it's important to us here at Kellogg. So is somebody else ringing the bell, Jenny, or is it not? It's not quite time. Does anybody want to ask one of the students? We have four students here right now that I'm sure would be willing to take a question about learning this way. Anybody? Or would you have something to offer that you've learned this way? Some of you had things in the gym that you had worked on. Sean, there was something of yours?
Yeah. I, for my seventh grade science project, we had to choose, we could either do science fair or an invention convention where you would create an invention and stuff like that. I chose to do science fair because it's something that I've never done before, so I decided to try it. And I did a project on aquaponics to see what was the best soil, I guess you could call it, to grow plants in an aquaponics system.
That's right, you can finish what you're saying, Kristen.
And it ended up going all the way, I think, third place in the state.
Right. Mm-hmm. And if you did get a chance to see it, we'll hope that you do get to see it. Thank you very much. I really appreciate your brilliance on that.
Thank you.
Culture building presentation.
I would like to introduce the teachers that will be presenting during this portion of the evening. My name is Julianne Flood, and I'm the physical education and health teacher here at Kellogg. Along with myself is Mark Fogel, our Spanish teacher, Joan Wingard, who teaches a combined third and fourth grade class, as well as fifth and sixth grade math, and Emilio Nichols, our Title I teacher. By the end of this informative session, you'll be able to describe how a Kellogg education builds students' dedication and commitment to character, community, and culture. That being said, I would like to bring your attention to our learning target for tonight, which is, I can describe how the special activities at Kellogg School help build character and support community for Kellogg students. Throughout our presentations, we would like you to keep this learning target in mind, as these are all important aspects of a child's education, which they are acquiring throughout their time here at Kellogg. During the course of our presentation, if you have any questions, please jot them down on your exit ticket provided for you. First, I'd like to talk to you about two ways we're building school community through multi-age grouping. Being a small school, we have many opportunities to bring students together for multi-age activities, and two of them we've done are World Water Day and Wellness Day. The first of these two theme days was developed when International Water Day, which is March 21st, came around, and it was decided that spending a day on the subject would be both educational and fun for the students. During the day, students learned why we need water to survive and the importance of having fresh water. As you can see in the second slide, students in 5th through 8th grade worked together and carried water from the Housatonic River. So imagine they walked down with empty containers and had to walk back uphill full to Kellogg School. This activity symbolized how some communities have to walk to retrieve water every day. Also at World Water Day, we took a school-wide vow to stop using plastic water bottles and only use reusable water bottles here at Kellogg. The kindergarten through fourth grade students worked together and learned about the different stages of the water cycle and how much water is in the ground versus the atmosphere. Last year we did Wellness Day, and throughout the day, students learned about how to eat right, stay fit, and be healthy. Students and faculty ate a family-style lunch together in the cafeteria, with each table consisting of a student from each grade and two teachers. Students also got an opportunity to try a healthy alternative drink of either a vegetable or fruit smoothie. Another portion of the day, students went outside and participated in a fun Zumba class. Performing Zumba was extremely beneficial because students of all ages could perform the movements and learn the mentality that it doesn't matter what you look like during the activity as long as you're staying physically active. Later, we again came together as a full school, faculty and students, in the multi-purpose room and did, oh, that's still on there, yoga, and did whole school yoga. The word yoga is derived from the Sanskrit word yuj, which means to unite or integrate. And during this time, Kellogg students as a whole worked on harmonizing the body with the mind and breath through the means of various breathing techniques, yoga postures, and meditation. Besides theme days, our other multi-age combining method is called bunches. Students get together at least once a month and either eat lunch followed by whole school recess or do a K-8-friendly activity to promote interaction between different age students. Having multi-age students and teachers together gives them an opportunity to get to know students of different ages and teachers they may not already know. Next, you're going to hear from Mark Fogel, who's going to talk to you about our Pay It Forward program.
Hello. There is a display on the bulletin board in the hallway leading down to the multi-purpose room that is signed by the students and staff. So I'll read it for you. It says, "We, students and staff of LHK School, will strive to uphold the Kellogg rules of being respectful, responsible, and safe citizens each and every day to create a positive and productive learning environment." Here at Kellogg, we have a goal to encourage positive behavior and build character. One of the ways that Kellogg helps to build character is through our Pay It Forward program. At the beginning of the school year, middle school students, with the guidance of teachers and staff, select four charities to support. This year, the four charities that were selected were Kiva, Fidelco Guide Dog Foundation, the American Cancer Society, the Falls Village Fuel Bank. Students learn about these charities when they participate. For example, students learn that Kiva is a nonprofit organization with a mission to connect people all over the world through lending to alleviate poverty. Students learn that Fidelco is a nonprofit organization in Bloomfield, Connecticut that breeds, trains, and places guide dogs with people who have visual disabilities. Students learn that the American Cancer Society is a nationwide voluntary health organization dedicated to eliminating cancer. And students learn that the Falls Village Fuel Bank is a nonprofit organization that uses contributions to provide assistance to families with their fuel bills. On that same bulletin board, there is a Pay It Forward display that reads, "Stay on track by doing what's right. Your actions will help others." We mean this literally. Students who exhibit positive behavior are recognized by teachers and staff and given a ticket that makes that student eligible to contribute to one of the four charities. Each week, the names of eight students who have exhibited positive behavior are selected. These students are recognized during the morning announcements, and then they decide which of the charities will receive a donation. Students really enjoy helping others in this way. By the way, every single student has made at least one donation to a charity this year. So doing the right thing leads to supporting a worthy cause. That is what we call paying it forward here at Lee H. Kellogg School. Amelia Nichols will present on student council.
Good evening. It has been so much fun taking on the role as one of the new co-student council advisors this year after Joan has done it for the past 28 years. While many schools have a student council, what makes the Kellogg Student Council unique is that we welcome all students in grades 5-8 that would like to join. Since there is no election process, any committed and willing students are given the opportunity to be involved. This year, we have one of the biggest councils ever with over 20 students. Being a member of student council provides great opportunities to take on leadership roles in our school. It fosters citizenship, allowing students to participate in representative government. It builds student competencies essential for the 21st century by helping them to learn how to present ideas, design and implement projects, and develop speaking and listening skills. Student Council supports service learning and the importance of giving back to your community. It also promotes school spirit and, as a result, improves school climate. The members of our student council take their roles very seriously. Being a member of our student council requires a lot of responsibility. The students run our meetings, come up with ideas, plan events, organize the fundraisers, promote school spirit, and manage our school store. They are 100% involved in planning and organizing the events and fundraisers that have now become memorable traditions at our school, including the Giving Tree and Food Drive, the Carnation Sale, the Regional Dance, and Spirit Week, just to name a few. All of the fundraising that they do helps to pay for some of the beloved events at Kellogg, including Monster Bash and Field Day, which again are planned and organized by our students. It has been a very exciting experience for myself and others to see just how dedicated our students are and how responsible they've become. Here is Joan Wingard to talk about fundraising in Quebec City.
Good evening. The Kellogg 8th grade trip is a culmination of 9 years together. It's a celebration and an amazing learning opportunity, not only in planning and hard work, but learning about another culture. The Kellogg 8th grade students get the opportunity to travel to another country, and they get there through hard work. The trip is fully paid for by fundraisers that the 8th grade parents and teacher advisors plan and execute. In the fall, the students rake leaves. They currently have 14 customers and rake from the end of October to the end of November on weekends and various other days when there's no school. In March is our annual lasagna dinner, and we've sold 400 tickets this last year. Each class generally will come up with a special fundraiser unique to their class. This year's class sold candy apples at the Scarecrow Festival in town. The Falls Village Recreation Committee hires the 8th grade to help with their Halloween party, Christmas tree lighting, and the Easter egg hunt. Recognize anybody? Throughout the year, pizza is sold on Fridays. Monthly bake sales are held at the Hunt Library. Ink cartridges and cell phones are sent to companies for a commission. And every Saturday, an 8th grade family picks up the returnables at the Falls Village transfer station and returns them for money. One can, one bottle at a time. The trip is not a gift, but a product of hard work by students, parents, and advisors. Quebec gives our students a chance to visit another country, experience crossing the border into Canada and back to the United States. They learn some history of Quebec and Canada and how it connects to the U.S. Students visit many landmarks of Quebec, eat all their meals together, and they have to learn to live with each other for a week. Upon arriving back from the very first trip that I took with the 8th grade, a parent told me, her daughter said, "It was like we were a family, Mom." That's a quote by Megan Cleary, a graduate of 2008. And this brings us to the end of our presentation. Please turn to the people at your table and share one way the special activities help students at Kellogg build character and support our community.
You can't take what
I wish I could have said more about the key first thing.
Yeah, well, I don't know what that is.
Yeah, what they do is you can give as long as $25 and they can get money.
Yeah, was your special activities, was that also a science project?
That was part of,
did you have to do it, or you just volunteer?
Some of it was volunteer, but some of it was curriculum. But,
so I did it. Yeah. Moved around, paying it forward to another.
Can you get into
another person?
Stay back.
Hello.
Hey, student ambassadors, are your groups here?
Yes.
Okay, great. All right, I have a few closing remarks to wrap it up for the evening. They lost their student ambassadors. Oh, I lost the student ambassadors. Very funny. Okay, I think we're all here. So welcome back. I hope you enjoyed your breakout sessions and that you are moving along with your learning targets and the mastery of your learning targets. One thing that was mentioned earlier is that we are a school that is forever evolving, and as it should be. We're continuously looking for ways to improve the educational experience, either directly or indirectly. And a couple things that I wanted to mention that didn't really fit into any of the other groups that are out there, but that are sort of the examples of how we are continually looking for ways to improve either directly or indirectly. For example, we are looking at our environmental practices, and Kellogg has always been a leader, ever since my children were very young and went to school here, a real leader in recycling. And this year we took a step further to try to reduce our waste, and I know that you heard about this in one of the other sessions a little bit, by encouraging students and staff to drink tap water and to bring reusable bottles to school to fill up in our newly installed water bottle refill stations. So if you didn't notice those, take a look out at the water fountain out there. One of them has a water bottle refill station, and then we have another one down towards the middle school wing. And we also made a pledge to not sell or serve bottled water at school events to encourage reusable bottles. This was an offshoot of the International Water Day celebration that you heard in the breakout session on character and culture. As of this past Monday, we have begun school-wide composting in all classrooms and in the lunchroom. And every Friday, we will be trucking that compost over to the school garden, the community garden that is between the school and the library. So that's a new initiative for us that we're pretty excited about. Another unique feature that I think is really worth mentioning has to do with our wireless. We have a full set, as you know, of small Acer laptops with open source Linux operating systems, as well as iPads that are about to be put into service to use with our students, K through 8. And this is new for us, as it was stalled for quite a number of years, wrestling with a debate over some inconclusive research in regards to the health and safety of wireless exposure on young bodies. And last summer, we installed wireless throughout the school, but with a twist. We had a custom designed script designed and made for us that allows us through the computer to turn off the wireless access points in the different parts of the building, or more, I guess, true to it, to turn them on when we need them, so that they're only on and only in the places where they're needed when they are needed. Otherwise, they're off. And this has required another step in lesson preparation for teachers, but we're pleased with our efforts to accommodate that concern. In closing, we'd like you to take a look back at the learning targets and ask you to reflect on where you think you are and assess yourself. Did you meet the target? Are you on your way? Or are you just beginning? This is a common practice, as you learned, in all of our classrooms, helping students to engage in their own assessment. We're going to employ a few of our strategies right now that we might use for quick checks of understanding. So with our first target, I can share how a Kellogg education builds a foundation for lifelong learning and active citizenship in the 21st century. We'd like you to give either a thumbs up, a thumbs down, or a thumbs in the middle. So thumbs up would be, I have met the target. In the middle would be, I'm on my way to being able to share. And thumbs down would, I really don't even have a clue yet how Kellogg could build a foundation for this. So let's see everybody's thumbs out there. You're gonna give a thumbs up, thumbs down, thumbs in the middle, and as the teacher, I look around and I see, and that's an important piece of it. So we don't just say, okay, everybody give a thumbs up, thumbs down there in the middle and move on. We look around and we see, what are our students telling us? who do we need to check in with, who might need a little bit of extra support, and so on. Okay, so for our second learning target, another way that we might check for understanding, so I can describe learning experiences at Kellogg and how these experiences foster high quality work and student engagement. We're going to ask you to give us a fist to five. So this is zero, that's a fist, and this is five. So on a scale of zero, which is I don't get it at all, to a five, I have mastered the target. A three would be a right smack in the middle, I'm on my way. Where do you think you are in assessing yourself in your way to in meeting that learning target? So let's see everybody's hand up there. You're going to give us a fist to five on where you think you are. Okay, great, thank you. And then our last one, finally, Kellogg. I can explain why Kellogg is a very special place. We're going to pretend that we're a windshield here. So if you absolutely have met this target and you could explain why Kellogg is a very special place, then you have a nice clear windshield. Maybe you went through a hatch of mayflies and so it's a little splattered, so you have some bugs on your windshield. This would be in the middle. And then, boy, you just went through a giant mud and it's really buzz up here and there's no way you can do that. So let's see everybody's windshield. Okay. All right. All right, so the next thing that we're going to do in our closing is ask you to take about 1.5 minutes, maybe 2 minutes, and I have a timer right here, to fill out your exit ticket. So you all got a pencil when you came in, and you've got your exit ticket, which is your piece of paper. And we're going to ask you to do a quick, what we call a quick stop and jot. It's another way that teachers assess the degree of which how well their students have made their targets. We're going to say that you can feel free to turn and talk to somebody that's in front of you or behind you if you want to help you fill this out. And you can turn and use the back of your chair as the surface for writing on. You can turn around and use the back of your chair to write on, unless you have a really hard leg. So go ahead, I'm going to give you about a minute and a half, and then I'll give you a 30-second warning. Come up and give out the door prizes.
Thank you for coming tonight, and we have some door prizes. So on your pencil, if you have won, you have a color piece, like a color sticker. And so if you have a pink sticker with checkers, it looks like this. You won a $10 gift certificate to the Hunt Library plant sale.
Everybody look at their pencil. So you're the winner.
If it's pink, with checkers.
And of course, our one out-of-town, far-away guest who came from Northampton has won the plant sale.
And you're also welcome to stay a little bit and look at the student work, but I also know it's getting late and many of us go to work tomorrow, so we may want to be going home. So, okay, so we're going to see a short testimonial, and then we're going to sing our school song.
Might want to gear up.
All that gibberish in the background was supposed to be. I have a solution, but it's in my classroom.
Well, I can run ahead and script if Joan wants to.
Oh, I can't put her on the spot.
What?
How about you just watch this beautiful slideshow and then we'll play it again with some sound? Wait, no, I have a better solution. Okay, we just can't have that. Okay, I'm gonna make this work. Some technological magic. You ready for this? Okay. Now, this is part of my technology lesson. Here we go. Where's the actual MP3? This is.
It's on the B drive.
I know I can't. Wait, the MP3 I had on here.
You had the top one, not the.
These are all MP4.
Can you access the video?
I can go to my room and get the original. Can everyone wait a minute? I'm fast running.
Okay, run!
Turn and talk, people! Turn and talk!
Given many opportunities to work with the primary grades,
and at one point I had my own spelling room. The friendships and skills that I learned here at Kellogg School are still with me today. Fast forward to finishing college, getting married, beginning a teaching career at Kellogg School, a dream I always had, and eventually moving back to Falls Village. Both my sons attended Lee Kellogg. They say it takes a village to raise children, and I felt incredibly lucky to have my sons share the same experience that I had here at Kellogg School. The sense of community in the school and the support of the town have made my parenting, residency, and my teaching an enriching experience. I love working at Kellogg School, having the opportunity to watch children grow and blossom in skills and confidence is incredibly rewarding. Kellogg is truly a very special place.
Yeah.